future, we will introduce the Earned Value Management System, which conceptually links the last step of the planning and the first step of the controlling phases of a project. Let's start with a brief sum up. In the planning phase, we've seen as how, in the very first step, we should define the scope of the project going through scope definition. Once we know what is and what is not part of our project, we can put in place two of the tools we discuss, the WBS for activities definition and the OBS for resource planning. These two views can be taken together with the RAM, defining who is going to do what and therefore defining the duration and the cost of activities. This means that we first define the cost control account with the cost control account definition, and then we can do the project schedule and the project cost. With all this information, we can define the project baseline. The project baseline is that tool that brings all this information together, creating indeed a baseline to control the execution of the project. It represents the starting point of the Earned Value Management System, also known as EVMS. Let's start from our needs. What would be a good output in the controlling phase? What should we know? Well, first of all, we would like to understand if we are on time or if we are ahead or behind the schedule. Still, this is not enough. We would also like to know if we are on cost or we are over cost or around the cost. Moreover, we'll also need to calculate somehow the final estimation, which means when and how, in terms of cost, we now plan to finish the project. In other words, we need to be able to forecast what is going to happen in the future, standing in the situation we have got now. It is a complex system, where we need to monitor many variables, such as scope, time, and cost, and to gather information from many sources to know, for example, the actual cost or the actual duration of the activities and how this will impact future activities. The first thing we can do to start considering some of these variables together is to create a time-phased budget. Said in other words, we need to know when the costs we plan are going to be used in the project. Let's assume we have got the following project. It has five activities, A, B, C, D, and E, with their predecessors, duration, and in this case, even cost. We have already built the Gantt chart, which says the project lasts 8 periods. While looking at the table, we can easily see how the total cost equals 210. The duration and the total cost are the first two input for the time phase budget that sees time on the horizontal axis and cost on the vertical axis. First, we need to make a very strong assumption, which is a linear relation between time and cost within the same activity. In other words, taking activity A, which lasts 3 and costs 30, we will consider a cost per period equal to 10. This is obviously a huge assumption, but this is needed to manage this method, which is pretty complex, in a feasible way. In advanced usage of the EVMS, we may remove this assumption for those activities that actually have a very different behavior than the linear one. Let's start building the time phase budget, starting from the Gantt chart. The time phase budget has on the horizontal axis the time and the cumulative budget on the vertical axis. In period 1, we'll be working only on activity A, as you can see from the Gantt chart, which we set as a cost per period equal to 10. Therefore, the first point of the time phase budget will be 10 in period 1. In period 2, will be the same situation, so we'll have a second point at 20, considering the cost of the second period. Please note here that the time phase budget is a cumulative curve, so it's summing the cost period after period. The third period will have the same impact, reaching 30. The situation changes in period 4. where we'll be working on activities B, C, and D at the same time. Activity B lasts 2 and costs 30, which means having a cost per period of 15. Activity C lasts 3 and costs 60. Therefore, it will have a cost per period of 20. And the activity D lasts 4 with a cost of 60, having therefore a cost per period of 15. This means that in period 4, the time phase budget will need to consider 3 different sources of cost, 15 coming from B, 20 coming from C, and 15 coming from D, for a total of 15, moving from 30 to 80. The same would happen in period 5, reaching 130. In period 6, activity B is over, so we'll need to consider 20 coming from C and 15 coming from D, but also 10 coming from E, which lasts 3, and has a cost of 30, having a cost per period of 10. This means that in period 6, we'll move from 130 to 175. In period 7, we'll have only activity D and activity E, which means a cost per period equal to 25, moving from 175 to 200. Finally, we'll have only activity E in period 8, moving from 200 to 210. 210 is exactly the value of the planned cost of this example, which is also known as budget at completion, BAC. This simple example is showing how our project will use the resources we plan over time. Also in this case, there are many softwares that, with the right information, would create this for us. Once again, I would invite you to use the tool, but to pay particular attention to understand how it works, to be sure that there are no other hypotheses or options in the calculation that you are not aware of, since you'll be using this tool to take relevant decisions on your project. The project baseline is usually an S-shaped curve, coherently with the expectation of the resource usage in the various phases of the project, a low consumption in initiating and planning, a strong resource usage in the execution phase, when we use material and we are actually working on the project, and then again a less expensive phase in the closing. The time phase budget has got also different names. It's known as baseline or BCWS, budgeted cost of work scheduled, which we'll see is the starting point of the controlling activities.